Hello. Welcome back to Doom. Let's try our very hardest not to get crushed to death this time. Unfortunately, I'm not sure why, but my saves are not working. This is the save that I would load, my autosave for Map 6, Halls of the Damned. Every time I try to load it, it acts like I'm using a different set of mods than I was last time, even though I'm not. They're the same mods. I'm not sure what's going on. I'm going to have to try manually saving next time and see if that works. But for now, I'm just going to have to pistol start it. Oops. I did not mean to shoot my gun there. I had to press control, the control key for a different reason to start something else. And control was also mapped to shoot gun, which is the default if you're not using the mouse. I'm gonna have to unset that. Well, we are off to a rollicking good start here. Yeah, after all of my grousing in the last video about pistol starting, it's quite ironic that I, myself, am forced into that situation. I don't know why my save isn't working. It's quite frustrating. But I will figure that out when I'm done with episode 2. Oh yeah. Okay, well, taking all that damage wasn't that big a deal since you have a berserk pack right there. Interesting. But yeah, I'm going to remember the room in which you get crushed to death this time, and I'm not going to get crushed to death. Of course, depending on where the arrow and the Keymaster are located, I might not even have to go there. I hope not, because I'm half expecting myself to forget and get crushed to death again. I thought about cheating and just adding exactly the items and health to my inventory that I had last time, and just pretending like none of this ever happened, but that is entirely too much work. I guess it wouldn't be that much work with GZ Doom. With the console commands, you can get pretty granular about the items you cheat into your inventory. Like, you can add just a specific amount of a certain type of ammo. You can set your health and armor to an exact amount. So, wouldn't be that much work. If I do get crushed to death, I can tell you this. This video is getting scrapped, and that's probably what I'm going to do, but since I'm already well into it here, if this video works out, then I will keep this recording, and you will have full access to all of my mistakes. We're doing this live, no editing. I mean, not live, pre-recorded for YouTube, but you know what I mean. This is off the cuff, this is unscripted, raw and uncut footage. which is kind of unusual for me. I haven't done a lot of non-streamed video game videos in a while. And the reason I'm doing it this way instead of a live stream is I don't have a lot of time during the week to stream, during the work week, because after my walk to work and my bus ride and walk back home, my workday is effectively 12 hours, 4 days a week, which leaves me, you know, about 4 hours in the day that's not devoted to work or sleep, which isn't a whole lot of time. And I have more time to stream on the weekends, but I have other stuff going on the weekends. And even though it's 3 days long instead of two, it's harder for me to find just a good long chunk of time to stream like I like to. But if I'm doing pre-recorded videos, it's a lot easier to just, you know, do this for an hour and have something to show for it. You know, I don't feel like, I would feel a little bad if I did a live stream for an hour, just because by the time people showed up or were aware of it, it would already be almost over. I'm playing real sloppy right now, but it's working out for me. Also, when I'm not streaming, it's less anxiety-inducing. Like, I can do stuff like, say, well, if this doesn't work out, I can just scrap the video and no one will ever see it. And that's not the case for live streams. And my anxiety's gotten a lot better over the last few years. I've started, you know, receiving treatment for it, and I made a lot of strides, but it is occasionally something that flares up. And, you know, there's been a lot of anxiety recently in general, just about general global pandemic situations, which isn't something I was going to get into in the videos, and I'm still not. I thought it was worth mentioning. If you're watching this in the future, we are in the midst of what is being called the coronavirus, or alternatively COVID-19. Which I thought COVID, COVID, I thought that, like, stood for something. Like, each letter, like, it was some sort of, you know, medical acronym, something very scientific sounding. But it's just an abbreviation for coronavirus disease, it turns out. So it is literally the same thing. I thought that was kind of funny. Oh god, okay. Didn't think I'd be able to use my rocket launcher there. Good thing I didn't try. But yeah, that's all I'm going to mention. It's a thing. It is not good. It is affecting a lot of people's lives in a very negative way. This is, you know, it's something you can watch to kind of forget about it for a little bit. So, yeah. But yeah, that's been another source of anxiety. So, it's, I mean, I'm fine. You know, my life hasn't been super affected by it personally. I know, you know, there are people close to me who have been affected by it, and it sucks for a lot of people. But, you know, I'm doing okay. It's bad, but, well, we'll get through it. But a lot of people are at home right now for an indeterminate amount of time, which is why I thought I should do something, turn the content fire hose back on. Hey! And this is easier for me than long 3-hour streams right now, so this is what you're getting. Nice. You You know, this isn't like a permanent thing. Like, I'm not done live streaming forever. This is just the form my content is going to take for a bit. And, you know, I always have people asking me when I'm going to do LPs again instead of streams, which I always thought is kind of a weird question, because to me they're the same thing. Like, the only difference between a stream and an LP in my mind is that, hey, for a stream, you know, you can watch it live. Obviously, you don't have to. I try to, you know, involve the chat, but not focus on them so much that it makes the video unwatchable in the archive. You know, that's why I always post the archive. And the only difference is, in an LP, I cut the video at arbitrary times, and in the stream, I just, I go. You know, like, when I'm recording an LP, like, even back in the old days when you could only upload, you know, 10-minute videos to YouTube, you know, I would still record for about the same amount of time, you know, 2 to 3 hours. I would just stop the recording every 10 minutes and make that a video. And for me, at least the way I watch videos and, you know, sometimes listen to videos, this is the same thing. You know, I don't watch an entire 3-hour stream archive in one sitting. I watch it, you know, at my leisure. Sort of the Netflix philosophy, where they will release an entire season of television at once and you can just watch it at your own pace. That's kind of how I see the stream archives. You know, that's how I watch them. So that's how I treat my own videos. Okay. I should do this now so I don't forget about it later. Because if I go looking... I might not have to go in that room at all. But if I do have to go in there, I will definitely remember and not get crushed to death. Mark my words. You know, after all my blustering the other day about how long Bowl of Heaven tracks are, this one is remarkably short by their standards. Like, it's only 15 minutes-ish. Oh, right. This one has the fake exit. Yeah, I kind of quickly hurried through this area the other day. Spoilers, it's been a day since the last recording. Keymaster Cockademon, eh? Well, I know the cure for that. A recommended dose of rocket launcher right to the face. It'll cure what ails ya. Do you have a cockademon problem? Try rocket launchers. Alright, I don't have to go into the crusher room. Heck yeah. Don't even have to worry about it. No getting crushed to death is in my future, or present. So that means I'm going to have to remember which direction I actually have to go to get out of here, and not just start picking doors randomly. I think this... no? Okay. Here we go. Yeah, the arrow that represents you on the auto map, it really needs to be like a larger triangle with a line coming out of the back, so you can actually see which direction you're pointing without zooming way in, because the default arrow is this kind of, like, you can sort of tell which end is which, but I don't like it. I never liked it. Okay, that's the getting crushed to death room. I just got turned around because I was complaining about map arrows. The one in Doom 64 is a little better. I played through Doom 64 recently. Not for the first time, but for the first time in a very long time. And that game's pretty dang good. I was playing the fan remake mod, Absolution, I think it's called, which is a variant, or I guess an updated version of the one that I played years ago, which I think was called Retribution, or maybe I have that backwards. But it's not a one-to-one, totally faithful, identical port of Doom 64, but it recreates the levels with the Doom 64 art faithfully, and adds some quality of life stuff. But it is pretty dang good. Alright, this way. Of course, it was on my mind because Doom 64 recently got an official port as a pre-order bonus for the new Doom game, Doom Eternal, and it also got a standalone release on, you know, Steam and possibly other platforms. Dang. Took me almost exactly the length of that track to finish that level. It's a long level. Starting to get pretty big. It's another one of my favorite tracks on the soundtrack. It's like a 45 minute psychedelic rock jam. It's pretty good. I tried to pace the music out a little bit, so that you have a nice, calm, ambient track followed by a cacophony. Not a cacophony, just a noisier, faster piece of music than the previous one. Using the chainsaw more than I normally do, which is weird because with this mod, I'm using a lot less ammo than I normally would, because I'm doing double damage once I pick up the arrow, but I've gotten pretty used to, or I've gotten good at picking out the moments where using the chainsaw is a good idea. Basically, anytime you're facing demons or cacodemons in a one-on-one kind of situation, it's a good idea to bust out the chainsaw, because they're not able to damage you while they're being chainsawed. Well, I mean, they are, but it's a lot harder for them to. Okay, so one of the features of the Doom engine is that the monsters have something called a pain value, which basically says, well, I guess it's a feature of the monsters. I might as well get this. Might as well get this too. I hate the inverted colors for the invincibility. So basically, when a monster gets hit with a projectile, they have a certain chance of being stunned for a moment, and that's called the pain value. I don't know, like, all the technical terms and stuff, but yeah, it's a thing. And cacodemons and demons the pink demons, pinky demons, they're more likely to be stunned and not have a chance to hit you back with the chainsaw and the chain gun, because it hits them so many times per second, or, you know, whatever. You know what I'm getting at. And of course, since demons don't have projectiles, and cockademons, their projectiles are pretty slow, it's easy to get right up in their face with a chainsaw. You just don't want to do that if there are too many of them around. But if you're in a nice little sectioned off corridor, and you can face them one at a time, it's usually a good idea to bring the chainsaw out. You might get hit once or twice. You know, I wouldn't recommend doing it if you have like 10 health. But if you have an ample supply of health, go for it. It'll save you some ammo. Which is a big deal in some of the later games on some of the higher difficulties, because they can be pretty stingy with the ammo. So, good to save as much as you can if possible. These level designs are just so, like, effortless to play. Like, they're so well designed. Like, I don't even have to look at my map for most of it. You know, I don't have these level layouts memorized or anything, but just everything is so smartly designed. It is so easy to sort of navigate it by feel. It is just a really pleasant experience, which is not something you get a lot in Doom 2. Like, I love Doom 2. It's a very different game than Doom 1. I love it for different reasons. But in Doom 2, the levels are gigantic and impossible to figure out. At least for me. I have a poor sense of direction, and I end up relying on my map a lot to figure out where the hell I haven't been. Where the hell I need to go. Oh, there's like a bullet decal on the door frame thing. It looked like a bug crawling up the wall. I was like, what? Doom doesn't have those. I don't know what the deal with this room is. So this thing is like electrified. If you stand there for a second, it damages you, and I don't know why. I don't know what this is supposed to be or represent. I thought it was a bug again. Get these damn bugs off my monitor. Ow. Okay. Oh, I can't go through this window? Bummer. Maybe I should have used this track on a higher energy level, because it's giving me a lot of energy right now, and this is kind of a slower, more methodical level. Of course, that's partially my poor sense of direction. Okay, this is the thing that I can't get up on top of. Of course, the track's gonna slow down in a second here. Starts out kind of high energy and then gets a little mellower. Alright, so I guess I'm going to have to go through here, hit by the electricity, and then go this way. No, I can't go through that. Okay, well, how do I get out of this section? I mean, there has to be a door leading out somewhere, right? Did I miss a door in here? Well, right after I say how well designed these levels are, and how effortless it is to navigate them. The game has to go and make me a liar. This is probably my fault, to be honest. Okay, there has to be an alternative way out of this room, right? Okay, so that... Oh, right. Yeah, this door's a little tricky to spot if you're not looking at the map. I only saw it because I saw the blue line down there, down and to the left of where my arrow is there. Doing pretty well for having to pistol star on level 6. Face itches. I think I'm subconsciously thinking about bugs now, because I thought there was a bug on the screen, or a bug in... Ow, no, bad. This track seems a little bit louder than the rest of them. And I did normalize all the music to approximately the same volume levels before I put the soundtrack together. I might have missed one though, because this seems, I mean, it's awesome, you know. It's I don't think it's too loud, it's just overpowering the sound effects a little bit. And it gives you 2 invincibilities on this level? Why? This level's not that hard. Of course, you know, at this point in Doom, it's pretty relaxing because there is a ceiling on how difficult it can be. Like, the hardest enemy we have is the Baron of Hell, because it hasn't introduced the Spider Mastermind or the Cyber Demon yet. So, you know, there's a certain amount of relaxation there. Like, oh, the worst it can throw at me is a Baron of Hell, you know? That's totally fine. I mean, it can throw a lot of Barons at you, and that can be stressful, potentially. Okay. So let's go this way. But these early Doom levels are pretty good about not throwing a ludicrous amount of stuff at you. Huh. There must be something you have to do to open this up, because that's a pretty basic secret otherwise. Like, oh, go down this hallway, that's a little hard to see. I guess there are a couple secrets like that. Just looking for paths that are a little out of the way. Alright, I should probably try to point out, or try to figure out where this compass is actually pointing me. So, okay. Okay, I see the general direction that I need to go. I think it's the direction that I need to go anyway to see about finishing the level. Oh, right. This way. No. What just teleported? Ah. Interesting feature about pickups in this game is that even when they're directly on top of me like this, I don't pick them up until I move, and they can be, you know, any direction. Just a tiny bit of movement causes the pickup to trigger, and that's something that I learned while I was making my mod. So if you're standing still, like even if it teleports you directly on top of something, an item, as long as you're standing still, you won't pick it up. Which can be good for situations where where something, you know, enemies trigger to come out when you pick something up. You know, keeping that in mind, if you just stand still for a minute, that can sometimes give you a moment to catch your breath before stuff starts spawning in. Speaking of spawning, that level was apparently the spawning vats. Alright, Tower of Babel. No Keymaster on this level. There's a master of something else, though. So this is one of the slowest, most kind of low energy ambient tracks on the soundtrack, which I thought was appropriate for the first time you meet the Cyber Demon. I think this track is called Even to the Edge of Doom. I think that's the title, which is, again, appropriate. Alright, so nothing to worry about on this level other than a few lost souls and the Cyber Demon. That's it. For some reason, I always want to think this level has two Cyber Demons on it if you play on Ultra Violence. And I'm not sure why. Like, there are all these, like... there are all these boxes scattered around the level. And... like... for some reason, I remember, or I think I remember, a version of this level where stuff comes out of these boxes. But even on Ultra Violence, like, all you have are a few lost souls and one Cyber Demon. And I think that's it. So I must be misremembering or remembering a similar level. Like, there's something just so fundamentally kind of creepy and unsettling about this music. Like, I think it's a good fit. Like, if there was a lot of shit on this level, I'd want a higher energy piece of music playing for it. But it's a pretty low-key level for, like, you know, a pretty big boss moment. You know, I'm taking my time a little bit because this is going to be a short video, because it's only three levels of the episode. Oh, hi. But yeah, one Cyber Demon isn't really that much of a threat, even. Like, Lost Souls are annoying, but as long as you get here with a decent amount of health, I mean, it gives you everything that you need to deal with it. Oh, hi. The Cyber Demon wanted some rockets. Well, I have some rockets for you, Cyber Demon. You could have just asked me. Here, I'll give them to you. What's this level called? Tower of Babel. There's not really anything Babel-like or Babel-like, if you prefer, about this level. I mean, maybe it's suggesting that I'm on top of the tower. Like, have I been working my way up the tower? I'm not really sure. You have to use your imagination with some of these level titles. But I think a more appropriate title for this level would have been Styx. S-T-Y-X, like the river Styx. Because Cyber, fun fact for the day, Cyber, I believe, comes from the Greek word Kyber, which means like ferryman. And, you know, the river Styx, famously, you have to be ferried across by someone, some mythological figure. I can't think of their name right now. Shit. It's not Cerberus, it's... this is gonna kill me. What's the name of the ferryman? I'll look it up after I take care of business here. But anyway, you know, sort of a weird connection there with the word cyber, which was always kind of intended to be a bullshit made up word, to be honest. Interesting fact about cyber demons. They do not take splash damage from rockets, unlike every other enemy in the game. And me, they only take damage from direct rocket hits, which is to prevent them from damaging themselves with all the rockets that they're constantly shooting. So for my mod, the Cyber Demon mod, hoofing it, I disabled that, or I re-enabled splash damage for them. Because, I mean, you know, you're facing down a ludicrous number of Cyber Demons, you know. I want to try to make it a little easier on you. Alright, the hideous Cyber Demon Lord that ruled the Lost Deimos Moonbase has been slain, and I am triumphant. Even to the edge of doom. Even to the edge of the moon. Repel? What do I have to repel with? Okay, River Styx Ferryman. Karen. Right. A ferryman of Hades who carries souls of the newly deceased across the River Styx and Acheron that divided the world of the living from the world of the dead. So yeah, weird sort of pseudo-connection there. And what exactly... Let me look up the actual meaning of cyber, or the actual origin of the term. Pretty sure it's Kyber, which is I don't know if anyone actually gets into it. From Cybernetic. Oh, okay. So it's more like steering. Kuberneticos. Good at steering, good pilot. Okay. So there's sort of a pseudo connection there. I don't know why I thought it had something to do with rivers or ferrymen. I mean, it's a very weak weak connection. Basically, it was just a cool sounding word that someone made up, and they had to bullshit an explanation for it. Now it's on to the final chapter of Doom, Inferno. Yes, as we all know, the last Doom episode ever made. No more Doom after this. I really dislike this background texture. It is not pleasant to read text on that. We are treated to this amazing JPEG of, I guess, that's supposed to be part of Deimos that's hovering above hell, I guess. I guess that's what this represents. Well, that's been it for The Shores of Hell. Tune in next time for episode 3, Inferno, in which I might actually start saving. I mean, I'm going to have to save, because if it's going to be difficult about my save files, then maybe manually saving will cause it to behave better. I don't know. I've never encountered this problem before, so hopefully I will get that figured out. But that will do it for this episode. Thanks for watching, and I will see you soon. Take care. Goodbye.